got one specific performance interest. Is anyone else specifically interested in this title, or are you more general, specific? We've got some specific performance interests at the front. Everyone else, if you're not testing background, is that more Scrum Master background, developer background?
Okay.
Scrum Master's at the back here.
Scrum Master's at the back, Dev's in the middle, performance at the front. Okay, that sounds like a good order. Okay, so as has been said, we're talking about performance testing specifically in CI. We're going to talk a bit about process, a bit about techniques, a bit about automation. We've got a bit of a demo to show you some of the automation that we've built and interesting stuff hopefully about that, which we'll do at the end, possibly during pizza, possibly before, depending how things go. So to get started, this is roughly the order of things. We'll keep it. I have updated this in the order of things.
We'll see what happens.
This is the thing with two authors. You might see one author change it, he changed it back in. But this is roughly what we'll look at. We're going to look at key stuff around performance, some interesting ideas around that, the problem of doing performance, as I'm sure most of you are aware, in Agile, DevOps, CI, all that sort of stuff, where it goes in the life cycle, and then some key things that need to be there to get the most out of it. So designing tests in a smart way, automating analysis in a smart way, and making sure you're not putting extra time into the developer feedback loop. And then hopefully a live demo with various stuff towards the end.
Thanks, that's good.
If you've got questions, shout them out, and let's keep this as interactive as possible, I think. And we will have question time after pizza if you want some time to digest your pizza and your thoughts as well. Okay, that's us. So I'm Thomas and he's Ian. You can read that already. You can read all that later if you want. So in short, let me just go back actually. Ian is a developer, so you developers can cheer for him.
Yeah.
I'm a consultant, ex-developer. I've designed the performance engineering services that we deliver at Fastas. We're a small consultancy based in London, and we do a lot of work with RS Components, which is why we're here today. And so that's roughly where we're coming from. And Do you want to talk about what they'll get from it?
Hopefully, I mean, if you're not getting this from this speak up, but you should be getting an understanding of how performance engineering is applied in Agile DevOps life cycles.
That's in the title.
I'll just read it word for word. You get a live demo of the automated analysis in CI pipeline. Really, the pipeline's not that interesting. It's what comes out the other side that's interesting, and that's, I guess, the secret sauce for us. And then hopefully that gives you some ideas on how to tackle your own problems.
So we'll take that secret sauce and make it a bit less secret by explaining how we do it. So hopefully it'll give you ideas to put in your own pipelines and develop yourself.
Yeah, I think that essentially covers things.
Was anyone expecting to get anything else from it?
We can.
Anything that we missed? We can add some slides in there.
We can update the PowerPoint.
let's proceed. Ooh, if I can get my left and right buttons sorted out. There we go. So what's performance? So if you're measuring performance, if you're running performance tests today, if you're measuring performance, what sort of things are you looking at? Any
speed?
Speed, speed. How fast things load, how long things take. Anything else?
Throughput,
yeah. How much can you do?
It's speed degradation under load.
So scalability. Is your speed scalable? Do things slow down when you put more load for it?
Memory usage.
Yeah, so there's like capacity of physical limited, or even scalable cloud resources, whatever it is.
What happens when you push it to breaking point? Do you lose data? Do you recover time?
Yeah, that's an interesting one. And you've got particular problems, I think, in these days where you've got a lot of distributed systems also interconnecting parts. You very quickly start to lose bits or cause unexpected things to happen when one bit degrades. Okay, so we've got seven pillars here which describe, we think, pretty much of what's covered by performance. So there's your standard stuff, response time, throughput. It's what users will notice if they can't put their pages through quickly enough on the website, if it's taking ages for the page to come back. That's the thing that the business is usually most interested in. You know, are the users seeing pages in a second, or is it taking 5 seconds and they're going shopping elsewhere, whatever they're doing? And how many users can I put through? Then there's capacity. We talked about capacity a bit, so that might be a capacity of your physical infrastructure, very limited. It could be a capacity of logical somethings like threads or connections or anything like that. It might be the capacity of your cloud infrastructure. Efficiency, I don't think you mentioned. So efficiency, I think, is becoming more key, particularly as people move into cloud, because efficiency is very directly related to your cost. So efficiency is how much stuff does it take to get things done. And if you have an application that uses one CPU to do something, another one which uses two CPU to do something, that one's now going to cost you twice as much to run that. And the thing with efficiency, I think, what we found is that the way cloud has driven things is a lot of developers are saying, well, it's fine, you know, I can put this out there, it will run, the cloud will grow to fit it. And of course, everyone's costs grow to fit it as well, and the budgets have to grow to fit it, and eventually the financial thing hits home. So efficiency, I think, is quite more key. We talked about scalability, so do all these other attributes scale? What happens when you throw more load? Does it stay fast? Does it stay efficient? Stability is similar, but does it continue over a period of time? So it might be fine today, it might be not so fine tomorrow, again perhaps when your memory is leaked or something else has happened. There was a bug in SQL Server we found actually with one of our clients. They have a very large SQL Server, it's one of the biggest in Europe. And they took a new version of SQL Server and they found their whole website fell over once a week and they restart it, everything would be fine. A week later it would suddenly fall over again because something hidden within the memory usage of SQL Server actually grew very slightly day in, day out, until it got to a point where there was no room to actually cache any data and the whole thing fell over. Resilience, we mentioned, and instrumentation, which is, you leave it to last, but it's not least, you've got to actually be able to measure all these other things, and that's a key requirement of performance. Anything missing from that? Any comments? Any
questions? There isn't any sort of histograms. I don't know what are important to you.
There's no order important, but I think it's a standard Microsoft Office clip art of things, so it's just how it draws it.
It's just interesting about Amazon's well architected framework, which they're pushing now. They talk a lot about efficiency.
Mm.
So it's a key thing with their well architected framework.
Yeah, I think efficiency, I've said this already, is becoming more and more important. But we'll look a bit more at this later, but not only in terms of cost saving, but if you're building something to be efficient, you can be much more confident about it at your results at a small scale, and that will scale upwards. If you're building big, clunky, inefficient services or methods or pages, you're going to hit problems with a lot of these other pillars. Okay, everyone, nothing too controversial there, I hope. Okay, so what are the challenges then to delivering performance testing today? This is really the context, I think, of the whole Agile and DevOps and CI and things going faster and faster. You know, we're in the whatever it is, the fourth industrial revolution, and you've gone from it taking weeks to cross the Atlantic to you expect to be able to real time everything to your friends the other side of the Atlantic day in, day out. So, you know, in the context of that revolution, what are the challenges that we're hitting with performance testing? John, it's your turn. You tell us what the challenges are.
Okay, all right, before. My perspective, moving faster into just more performance risk. the more we try to release, the quicker, the more we seem to introduce these performance defects.
I think an important thing there as well is, you know, obviously the whole thing about moving faster and releasing more frequently is that you should be releasing much smaller increments with less risk inherent in
there. Yeah.
And the thing is, if you're, we find this with our customers, if they're releasing functional defects, you spot it quickly, you roll it back, you know, talk about off whatever you do. If you're releasing a performance issue, unless it's a very obvious thing in the first pillar, and it's your response time's got from 1 second to 3 seconds, okay, you spot it, you roll it back. If it's your website will now crash at the next peak, you don't know that until the next peak when it crashes, and you have to start again. And then you have to say, okay, I've released 1,000 releases since my last peak. Which of those 1,000 releases actually caused the crash that I've seen today? Does that make sense?
So performance risk.
I guess what
you just said is that if you're releasing, if you're, you know, your cadence is so high that once you actually uncover something that's actually going to cause major performance defects, you're not going to be able to do it well as easily. It's going to become more expensive to fix that if you're, again, as Tom said, 1,000 releases down the line, and if you're trying to find what could be a line of code somewhere, you know, a thousand check-ins ago.
So you've got a whole different definition of what a cycle is as well, haven't you? You've got lots of different cycles interacting. It's not the old days where you had 6 months to performance test at the end of a 4-year project or whatever. I don't know how often you guys are releasing or building, but is anyone releasing multiple times a day? Anyone in that stage?
Potentially.
Most people releasing weekly, that sort of frequency. Monthly, yearly. I mean, but even monthly, even if you're releasing every 2 months, it means you don't have 3 weeks to do your performance testing at the end of that cycle. And it's a whole different approach from where we were just 4 or 5 years ago. So we're pressing that wrong mouse button here.
So this one's sort of a big challenge that that in some of the clients that we've actually sort of taken this approach of trying to integrate with their within their CI environments is that we can't slow down their rate of delivery, and the things that we have to do are mostly around how we design performance tests and to actually expose some of those performance risks that you mightn't see unless, without having to go up to a full-size environment. You have to be smart about how you go about exposing those risks. So we have to do this with really short, sharp performance tests, probably not to the scale that I guess you would expect. But, you know, from my perspective, analysis is that traditionally it's been people who perform the analysis, people are slow to make mistakes. Thomas is guilty of that.
Yeah.
So it's basically trying to, we're trying to take all that knowledge of how to spot the performance pathologies that are dangerous and at the same time not slow them down.
So we used to, we've done one of our clients is EasyJet. We've worked with them for about 10 years. Back when we first started with them, they would release, I think, once every quarter. And we would spend a month or so running some performance tests before that release. And then we'd probably tell them the day before the release, hey, it's no good, go back and rewrite it. They'd delay the release a week and another week and another week. And they'd rewrite it and finally get it out. Then it got to a stage where they wanted to release every month, and suddenly you don't have that luxury, and now that you want to release every week, and you really don't have that luxury. And one of the reasons we started looking at this whole thing, we ended up looking at how we build this into CI, how we get it into the development pipelines, how we integrate it with the dev teams. We used to have a team of juniors basically doing this analysis every morning. So we were saying, we're going to be really efficient, we're going to run tests every night. Back in those days, that was pretty good. We're going to run tests every night, and then we're going to get the results out sometime next day. And four juniors would come in the morning, the junior analysts, and they would sit down and they would go through all that data. And sometime around 2 p.m, they'd actually have some results, and they'd put it all in an email and send it off to someone. And then the developers would go, I've got time to fix this before tonight. We'd run the test again that night, and we'd do the analysis again, and yes, it would still be broken, and eventually the developers would get around to fixing it. So it's about stopping that whole cycle where you've got this huge feedback loop, and it takes longer to report stuff than it does to actually fix the thing. Oh, and my skill set is no longer fit for purpose, basically.
There you go.
But yeah, gone are the days where you had a performance tester who just did that. You've got combined teams, DevOps teams, people who need to know the structure of the application as well as knowing the stuff about performance, and people who need to be able to apply that quickly to really pinpoint where issues are at.
Could I make a suggestion for something else in that one particular challenge I find in the cloud environment? You don't have control over your neighbours in the cloud, so your testing might go great because you're running on a light host at the time of the testing, but when it comes to production, it's running on a heavily subscribed host.
Yeah.
In which case, your application might run like a dog as a result.
Yeah.
It's done all the right things.
Yeah.
But that's completely out of control.
Yeah. There's certainly other things we could put on there. The whole distributed system development is as another complexity in there as well. Like if something slows down, is it you or your neighbour, the neighbour then? And if all those are in the cloud, then is it that one's host that's slowing down, and so on and so forth? So
yeah.
You've got a lot more parameters that you're looking at. So this is the diagram that we use to show how performance engineering fits into a development life cycle. So you've got your life cycle activities across the top. That's not necessarily in sequence, but these are things that you're doing. You would do requirements of some sort, some kind of design build, some kind of testing, some kind of release process. And within that, all the blue stuff down the bottom is all the performance related things that can be happening to make sure that you've got the performance built into the application. And the big thing that we're saying here, which we'll elaborate on a bit, is the importance of thinking about this right from the start. So this is a full life cycle approach to performance. Right, think about right from the start and right up to the end as well. So you shift left as far as you can go, and then you shift right as well to catch the stuff that's left over. And the other thing is everything being driven by risk. So the idea here is you've got your concepts, your ideas, your stories, whatever they are, and the first thing you're doing with that is you're modelling the risk around it. So you're understanding, I've got this story that's landed on us, what is the performance risk, what's likely to go wrong, how many users might that impact, what type of reputational damage might that cause. And having this business performance related mindset is one of the key skills of the new performance person in a DevOps environment. Being able to relate back what's happening with this particular service and the changes that we're making with this user story to how that impacts the business's goals around business capacity and conversion rates and everything else that's happening. So understanding that risk will then drive a number of different mitigations. So it might be within the relevant team reviewing code with each other. One thing that we tend to recommend to our clients is they have some kind of performance champion in each DevOps team who takes ownership effectively of the performance that's going through there, and they can review stuff with people.
Yeah, I just want to ask, when you say performance testing, is it only, does it have to do with load testing, or is it a combination of load testing, stress testing?
it's any kind of testing which is going to answer those seven pillars. So it might be stress testing to look at the scalability. It might be load testing to look at the throughput. It might be just a single user measuring it in Google Chrome. You know, that's still performance. We're still measuring the speed in that case. So and that's a really important point, because what we've got, what we've put on here is effectively those different stages. So it might be that, okay, you read the performance and that's all right, but we need to check some tests. And it might be say, okay, let's build some unit tests which measure just, you know, simple start time, stopper time, how long does it take in a dev environment? Is it any slower this build than it was last build? And you know, that's not going to tell you if it's scalable, it's not going to tell you if it's efficient, but it is going to answer that simplest question of, is it really, really slow? And you can catch, sorry to say, you can catch probably too many things at that stage, which you shouldn't have to. And then it might be that you're doing early load testing of perhaps an individual service, just at really low loads in a really tiny environment. You might start integrating those services and running that in a bigger pipeline, a bigger environment. You might look at the user experience, even something like Selenium or some kind of browser driver. And then you might say, forget all that, let's just look at it in production, run a test there, because we know our next peak is in for a couple of months and we can live till then. So the important thing about all this stuff here is it's all driven by that risk. So if you understand the risk, then you can make the right decisions to mitigate that risk in a way that's quick and cheap and doesn't get in anyone's way. And all these types of testing we're talking about can all be driven through a continuous delivery pipeline. You might have unit tests that run on your own workstation, you might have a small environment where you're testing your own team's set code, that might go through into a bigger environment where all the different teams' code is coming together. They might go into production, you might run the same set of tests there, and again perform that analysis and link everything back together. Does that make sense in terms of approach, what we're saying? Yeah? So understand the risk, do stuff as early as you can, but remember that there may be risks that you can only see later on. That's when things join together, or even when it's gone into production.
Do you expect input by analysts? So if you're saying, right, on a story by story basis, we're going to find maybe this risk in another story, do you get any, do analysts bring any of that forward, or is that just dead bottom?
Yeah, so ideally we have input from the analysts on that. So usually what we do is we work with the teams in through maturing and through elaboration, whatever you end up calling it, and through sprint planning. And so the inputs, where the analysts are being involved in setting functional requirements, you have to make them think at the same time about the non-functional requirements, what the business actually wants it to do. And if you read most sets of non-functional requirements that are just pushed down from above, it's like, I took the standard template and I wrote the number 3 is the response time and that was it. You've got to actually be involved in that process and be engaged. So that's is often the tricky bit. But if you can get that working relationship with the analysts and even the business and further upstream, I think that's one of the key skill sets in the new performance person's armoury. Move on?
I think so.
There's something gone wrong with the animation. That little fish got left out. Do you want to talk about a little fish?
Half a man's issue.
There's a little fish there, coach. So if you want to be able to performance test smart, if you're able to perform test fast, we have to do it smart, is what we're saying here. That little fish will come into it somewhere.
Did you test your slides?
We didn't test our slides, no. We performance tested them, they were so fast. We didn't functionally test them. We didn't test the user experience. But fast performance testing, it needs to be smart. We need to go about this the right way. And we need intelligence coming into this to say, this is how we test, this is how we're going to design these tests, and this is why we're testing. I don't know if you probably know the old Facebook slogan, you move fast and break things, and you just keep on moving and you break things and you know you're going at speed because you've broken something. You probably know that a couple of years ago they publicly renounced that, and they said actually what happened was we moved fast and we broke things, and then we ended up spending lots of time fixing things we broke, so we ended up moving slowly. So the way to move fast, we're saying, is let's move smart. If we're moving smart and moving smart to avoid breaking things, then we're going to keep on moving fast. And we're not going to have the Facebook syndrome of, yeah, we go fast, and then we go slow. There's your little pictures, aren't they? There's your little fish that got their part of it. You want to talk about systems? You know about systems, you can talk about system knowledge. I'll talk about fish.
well, I guess it's if you want to be smart about it, you need to know, I guess, what you're testing. So if you want to actually design smart tests to actually expose performance defects, you sort of know how to. Well, I guess you're the performance test. You tell me.
I think it's you. I think you need to tell me. I think it's where the developer is something the performance tester doesn't.
I'm not sure I know enough about my systems to design.
But when the developer should have something, the performance system doesn't. It's in the old world. You threw something in the fence. The performance system picked it up. In the new world, this is where DevOps is a big help. You own that software. You own the performance of that software, and it's the people who wrote it, and the people who really understand, hopefully, what they've written.
Yeah.
The people who really understand what they've written, who own the performance of it. And having that system knowledge coming into the whole performance testing and performance assurance process is critical to getting it smart and getting it fast. Yes, you still got to have the performance understanding, which the developer doesn't necessarily have himself, but it's bringing those two worlds together and making them into one world of people who care about performance, care about the system, know about the system, and know about performance as well. That's what you were going to say, wasn't
it? That's exactly what I was going to say about it.
And then, knowing about the system, you target your tests to basically float up the risks that you care about.
Yeah.
Yeah. So rather than saying, hey, I'm going to test every page on this website and I'm going to test every service that's been built to the nth degree, if we understand the system, we already understand where those memory leaks might start happening. We already understand which service is going to be CPU intensive because it has a whatever complexity. So bringing that knowledge in, we can focus the extraordinary risk mitigations where they're actually necessary. And by and large, we can do things a lot more quicker and more simply for the general scope of things.
So do you end up with a kind of a risk register? You're sort of thinking about the impact of this is quite high, but the likelihood is low, so we might not target that. Whereas impact high, likelihood high, that's it.
Yeah, exactly. So
you're going to almost risk registers across the board.
Yeah. So as if you're working in like a sort of Scrum sort of system or something, you know, where the developers are sitting there and estimating time or whatever, the performance person is estimating complexity. The performance person is sitting there estimating the risk and they're maintaining a register of what those risks are and how likely they are to happen. Sometimes the best way to do it is, you've got your JIRA board or whatever, and somewhere in your JIRA sticky is a field which says performance risk. How likely is this to break at peak time? And if they select very likely, then it turns the ticket red or something, and people know to put a bit of extra focus on it. And stuff like that can be really invaluable to impacting the culture of the whole team and making them really think hard about where things might cause big non-functional issues, as well as is it actually going to work. And then that, it drives obviously the target test, but also just thinking back to the previous slide, we've talked about doing performance reviews. What you then do is say, this is a high-risk item, let's make sure this is reviewed by the performance champion, or we check this out with the architects, or we get the performance guys to have a look over it before we actually even check it in, before we actually even start running tests on it. There's our little fish.
Strange friend.
He's got a friend, yes.
Sorry, I want to ask something about the risk figure. So is it possible for a feature from a functional perspective to be high risk and in the non-functional, which is the performance has to be lowest possible?
Yes, I think so. So think about examples. So you might have something which, you know, is, you might have some special feature which is very rarely used, for example, and it might have a very, it might have a complex set of functionality in that, you know, people go through multiple steps, perhaps there's a field where there's lots of different options, but it may not do anything particularly complex with the information behind the scenes. Okay, so you've got a form which you're filling in an option on page one, and then that presents, based on that, presents you a set of options on page two, based on that presents you a set of options on page three. But, you know, it all runs in JavaScript. It's all it's doing is presenting static data. The performance risk is very low, but there's probably a big chance that someone may have got the rules slightly wrong, so it shows you the wrong data on step two. So the functional risk might be a lot higher. So there's a good chance it'll go wrong, but if it goes wrong, it's not going to break anything. It's just got to stop people from actually using that piece of functionality. So that's why I'm keeping, I think, performance risk separate from functional risk. And probably you'd have, if you're doing your DevSecOps, you've probably got security risk as well in there somewhere, which is, this is particularly security risky. If it's allowing people to directly query the database or something. Yeah, do you want to talk about sizing? You can talk about the fish. Since I talked about the brain. Okay, I'll talk about fish.
I think I could do it last.
You talk about the little fish, I'll talk about the big fish.
Yeah.
So I think the point here is that we're sizing stuff based on that risk. So, you know, you've known the system, we understand the risk up front. Do we really need to run a 24-hour test in a full-scale environment? Can we run a one-minute test in a little VM that we're spinning up on a box somewhere?
That's exactly what you're going to see in a bit.
Which is what we're going to show in a bit. Not 24-hour, but let's size our environments and size our time and size the volume of our tests based on the risks that we're trying to spot. Yeah, so if in that case we've got that form which is all loaded in JavaScript, probably the only thing I care about is how long does it take for that initial page to load? Is this JavaScript so huge it'll take ages to load off the server? In which case I might just load it in Chrome and have a look at it and say, yeah, that's good, and sign it off. Whereas if I'm building a complex something which, you know, consumes memory and queries the database and caches stuff gradually over time, I might run a much longer test. I might need to run a longer test to actually get into the details of what's happening there. But the idea is your big fish should be few and far between. Lots of little fish, a few big fish. Oh, there you are. You can be the diver.
So, talk about the diver. Without giving too much away from what's later on the slide. So, I guess with the sort of traditional way that, you know, our guys who would have been analyzing performance tests, is that there's so much, you're throwing a plethora of data at them on potentially a daily basis, like Tom's described in how we were doing regression testing. You're only going to be able to look at so much, and some of that's not going to show you some of the more important. Well, it's going to be covering up a lot of things potentially going on further down. And you know, metrics you might actually be looking at frequently enough. You might just be looking at, you know, your CPU process time, your heap size, stuff like that. And then you're missing out something, you know, very small, very, very troubling sort of gradual increase that could potentially happen over time. And you're not catching it because there's so much there to look at that, possibly hope to do that if you're doing it by hand. That sort of deep dive analysis.
Even some of the automation techniques.
I don't want to give it all away.
Because
you could leave now if I give it all away. But yeah, that's I guess the problem that you gave me, and that's what I went on to try and with my team to try and solve.
The thing with the depth as well is, it's if you're running smaller tests and shorter tests, you need to go a lot deeper in to actually see what's going on. You can run a you could, if you can, if you've got the time and the leisure and the environment and everything to precisely emulate what your customers will do over the course of the peak week in the year, then you can do that. You can say, "Will the customer's happy? Your all response time's under 1 second, or whatever." Yeah, tick in the box, we're good to go. If you've got 10 minutes or 5 minutes or 1 minute, you're never going to find that out by just looking at whether the response time's good. You're going to look right inside the application and see troubling signs of things starting to go wrong, which are going to worry you and which you're going to fix before they get out there and start causing a big trouble.
And we'll see some of these actually in a completely representative scenario.
He's an expert at building a non-formed application.
Yeah, exactly.
We'll see that later.
Is there a conflict between the good analysis and trying to do it fast?
Yeah, that's where the need to automate stuff comes in as well. So if we can automate, and this is what we'll look at a bit later, some of the techniques we use for that, if we can automate the eyes scanning through all of the metrics, so we no longer have to have our four juniors sitting there for 5 hours, but we have some algorithms sitting there for 5 minutes, then we can get away from that taking forever. I'll go through this one because Ian didn't want this slide in there, but
I had to know this one came from the last minute.
There's just some things, some practical things out from the previous slide. So, what does some auto testing look like? If you go back to our full list of, I put three of them in there, but our full list of seven things. We need to always keep those in mind. We're not just looking, is it fast and what's the throughput like, but is it scalable, efficient, stable, everything else. We've got to target the key services or key pages or whatever. Don't just spread your effort across everything. We've got a target where there's complexity. I was saying that if the performance risk is low, don't waste your time on it. Design your tests based on the risks. So as I mentioned about, are we doing stress tests or load tests or soak tests? We'll do whatever is needed based on what the risk is. Like, if we think the risk is that something might degrade over a long period of time, we may have to run a test like that. But we want to design even our short tests to flush out examples of risk really early. We'll see a bit of that in the demo. I've got a slide on that later as well. But you know, running a lot of test approaches, you know, people are like to use Gatling or something and just let's fire 1,000 requests and see what happens. It tells you something. It tells you something about the response time of that sort of load. But unless you're doing clever things like varying the load through the test or trying out different combinations of services through the test, you're not really going to pick out the underlying topologies which are going to let you see what happened in a big scenario. Sizing the environment, we talked about that a bit already. Sizing the environment appropriately, don't just go out and recreate what you have in production necessarily. Schedule resources, so one thing that we've looked at, smarter testing, and this comes out to cost a bit as well, is you know, you fart the testing environment where you need it, you pull it down when you don't. We work with customers using Docker containers. You just fart the container, run your test, kill the container. If you need to run 5 tests at once, then you fart 5 containers. And you can do smart stuff around that to make sure you're not slowing down any pipelines. And then the detailed platform analysis. So not just the detailed stuff within the application, but get into the nuts and bolts of what's happening on the platform. Is there queue building up on the CPU? What's happening in terms of how it's handling the memory? Are we paging too much stuff to disk and that sort of stuff? Okay, you can talk about this. This is you.
Yeah, I guess most of it is.
let me have a break.
Okay, right.
So, I guess the title now. How do we, as a collectivist, how do we do that? So we built our own tool. It's called Test Analysis Tool. We called it TNT, but that was to avoid calling it TAT. So that came from a problem specification that Thomas, you know, threw down to me, that was to improve the speed at which we could deliver performance analysis on. In the beginning, it was these nightly tests that the analyst would be analyzing by hand, And you know, these would be sort of fairly large tests, and it would be how long did you say it would take? Most of the day.
Yeah, it's like five hours for four people.
I think. Yeah. So, I haven't got exact figures. Like, all I've got, that's just purely anecdotal. So, we built this up, and it allowed them to start to do, you know, that sort of manual analysis in, I guess, less than half the time with less than half the resources.
And then it got less and less, and we started thinking, hey, we could just put this in a pipeline.
Yeah.
not sack the juniors, but get to do something more interesting.
Yeah, I guess. I wouldn't expect them to. The bit where it was just like, hey, Ian, do you think you could do this even faster than that? How do we do it? So we have a service metric framework.
What tools do you use to implement this framework? Is it Lodrona or Jamita?
It doesn't matter. We built it because of the variety of tools that depended on the customer would use. I mean, they're
lots of customers, and they all use the tool sets.
That was part of the problem specification, was that this needs to work with pretty much everything, and the service metric framework that we've got means that there's no, well, I guess it creates sort of a universal sort of language for analyzing metrics. These same concepts that we're looking at are applicable to everything, you know.
Yeah, I think we narrowed it down to there's like sort of 15 key things you want to monitor about anything, whether it's a server or a thread pool or something. You want to monitor how much resource is being used, you want to monitor how much of a queue is building up, you want to monitor how long it takes to go through that component. So there's a number of key things that you want to measure at every layer of your stack. So right down to the hardware, up to the application layer, up to what's going on with the browser, all of that really conforms to this pattern of 15 key things or less.
Back to this, like, what tools does it work with? We try to make it work with everything. It's CI independent what you want, like what clients want. My problem was to make it work with everything. We've seen Jenkins. Internally, we have Visual Studio Online, so we use their pipeline tools. But I mean, it's the tool set that we developed is meant to work with everything. So then we do a couple of things before we start to do the clever bit. So if you can imagine checking a bit of code, it would run a performance test. Our tooling would pick up all sort of monitoring, native, APM, whatever. It would pick it up. We'd look at a couple of different things before we get to matching the expected pattern. So we'd compare it to prescribed thresholds, so things like response time, whether or not that's acceptable. We'd be comparing it to the baseline, so you don't want to be getting worse. You might be getting imperceivably worse, but you don't want to be. We want to make sure that as we're going along, we don't have. It might be incrementally worse between check-ins, but from check-in zero to check-in 1,000 can be.
Where I work I have you guys say baseline. So what is the criteria? How do you identify a baseline for any application?
There's a couple of things there, I think. So it's a fairly common technique for measuring performance across multiple builds, across multiple releases. What we decided to do in the end was two things. So we say let's always measure back to a point in time, so let's say the last release or how it was last week. So that's our good baseline we start from. So we all measure back to that. But then also, what we found then was you measure back to that and that's fine, says everything's okay. But then you get into a situation where you optimize something and it improves. So maybe now it's half what it was in the baseline. And then someone breaks that again, it goes back up, but it's still okay because it's still no worse. So you're measuring back to a fixed baseline, then we're also measuring a rolling baseline against the last good build. So you can see, has it got worse than what we last released, say? But also, have we lost the optimizations that we've built since then? There's a number of different ways you can do it, but that seems a good combination.
Thank you.
What point of the development cycle do you run this automated test? Is it once the entire integration has happened, or how is it? Are we checking?
So this could happen, it could happen at any point, okay? So once you're doing this and you've got it automated, there's no reason to set perhaps the capacity of your environment that you can't do every check-in. So you check in something, you've already identified the metrics, you compare what you run your test, you compare it to the thresholds, you compare it back to the last check-in, you compare it back to your fixed point, you do the clever stuff, like instead about matching the patterns,
yeah.
Look for things which are displaying pathologies that shouldn't be there, and then say pass or fail. And you can do that each check-in. So each check-in, you run your short test, do all the checks, pass or fail. If it's fail, back to the developers to see what's going on.
Probably practically speaking, identifying a performance criteria and identifying sort of stories which might affect the performance.
Mm.
What is that criteria which you guys?
In terms of identifying the risk up front,
yeah.
So there's we have a sort of checklist that we use with various things on it. The biggest things are usually around the expected volumes through that, and the complexity. So we work with a DevOps team basically to understand the complexity of what they're building. There's usually a few other things that we throw in as well. Like one client, we know that every time they touch a certain database, something goes wrong. So that's on the checklist. But with another client, we know that every time a certain, I think maybe the same client actually, every time a certain team gets involved, they completely break the performance. So they're on our checklist. So
you don't have individual names, are you?
No, I don't think we ever got quite that far, but almost. So
there's some gotchas, isn't there? Sort of third party integrations.
Yeah, there's
the public internet.
Yeah, and then the other thing on our checklist is, does it match any of these general things that we've seen elsewhere, which is, yeah, like you say, are they integrating with third party, stuff like that. So you build up experience over time, sort of general experience and also team specific experience as well.
Okay.
So, yeah, just on that, there's match expected patterns. We've got a bunch of things we look for.
I'm going to explain about this.
I don't know. It might.
You put
probably
do it. You put pattern sliding.
You didn't see the pattern slides. And then as you say, pass or fail. Some people like pass or fail. I know that there's one client we work with, they don't like fail, so they go for advisory. But I mean, it's really up to however you want. But I guess they were uncomfortable with this coming in and just halting everything.
I suppose it's what you do with a fail, isn't
yeah.
it? Do you stop the pipeline, or do you say there's something to look at, pay some attention to it?
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay, so pattern matching, what were we talking about there? So performance, pathologies, it's basically patterns of things that might go wrong. So I've got some fairly straightforward examples here, I think. So so this is response time over the course of a test. Is that good or bad? Any votes for good? Any votes for bad? Yeah, really, do we? It's nice and flat. We don't, we've not got an axis, but there's nothing there to tell us it's bad. So we say, it's good. If you compare it to baselines and compare it to thresholds, that's why you have the other two things in there, you might spot something which says it is bad. But if you see response times like that, is that good or bad?
Well, it depends on. If the response time goes up, it means it takes longer to return.
Yeah.
That's bad. If it is shorter, that you request and it comes back quicker, which means the time taking reduced is good.
So this bit's quite good. That bit's not so good, isn't it?
Yeah.
but what we're seeing there is a pattern that you wouldn't want to expect to happen. So whatever you're doing over the course of a test, you don't want to see the response time start to shift. So stable response time, so the response time staying flat is always a good pattern. It's a very simple one. But if that's increasing over time or increasing with increasing load, then there's something going on in there which you don't want to have. Does that make sense? Anyone?
Yeah, it gets so complicated when you throw caching in there and things like
yeah.
that.
Yeah, but you still don't expect it to increase over time. So caching might mean it's decreasing over time, so that's not necessarily a bad thing.
Or going like this.
Or going like this, potentially,
as
yeah.
the cache gets old and stale.
But this is a pattern, generally speaking,
yes.
you would want to see. Now, again, your system knowledge is going to feed into this, okay? So you might say, we have a range that we know it varies. You know, it does this with the caching. So anywhere between there and there, we don't care. If it starts to go beyond that, then we do start to care. And running this in a small environment, yeah, the big thing, the reason I'm not putting axes on there, we don't really care what level it's got up to. You know, we're here perhaps running a 5-minute test in a cut-down environment at a low load, and if we're seeing that happen, then that's bad news for once we start giving it to real users to play with at high load in a production environment. Okay, so let me tell you, our test here has 5 equal stages of load, and it's ramping up every 2 minutes. Is that a good CPU utilization?
It's not bad.
It's nice and nice level, is it? It's growing linearly, at least. So that's a good pattern. Again, it might be going up to 100%, it might be going up to 10%, but the pattern itself is a good pattern. That one there. Yes, yeah, so may not be so good. Yeah, whether this line up here is 100 or 10%, there's something happening that shouldn't be happening in that one. Remember we said equal stages of load. Yeah, we went up from three loads to 4 loads, and our CPU utilization more than doubled. So there's something inefficient in the scalability in that system. So, okay, same test, our throughput is doing that. Very nice, yeah. So same test, our throughput does that. Okay. something bottlenecking in our test at that stage, we can't get more throughput from. These are fairly high level metrics, but we can apply the same thing to anything down the covers. You don't want the CPU queue to be growing. You don't want the things like memory and heaps are slightly different, but you don't want them to start growing exponentially out of control.
So what you said with your tool that I won't name, you've encapsulated this kind of thing in some kind of DSL type language. You can describe this kind of these patterns that you consider good or bad in some high level way.
So what we've done with our framework is we've brought everything down to 3 fundamental patterns. I think that the third one is probably this. So resource locking. You probably want it to be as near zero as possible. It's doing that, it's probably not so good.
Yeah.
So we bring everything down to 3 patterns, so we call them wrap, zero, and flat. So either it's flat, okay, response time is a flat. You want it to stay flat, whatever, pretty much whatever you do to it. Maybe up and down a bit, but flat.
Yeah,
no growing. CPU utilization is ramping. Okay, you want it to increase fairly linearly. If it's starting to do that, it's not a good thing.
Yeah.
Throughput again is a ramp. It should be ramping linearly. Resource locks is a zero or close to zero. So any metric that we're monitoring in this framework, we can map out to one of those patterns. So we're saying, is it increasing linearly? And we're saying, is it staying flat? Or we're saying, is it staying near zero? And then, what's that like you touched on, there will be tweaks to calibrate that. So, how flat is flat? maybe this is flat, maybe anywhere in between there and there is flat. We don't care about those slight variations. So that calibration is important. Maybe our lineup here is 0.0001, and maybe this is zero, as far as we care. So that calibration you have to do then per metric. But if you can match everything back against those three patterns, then you're well on the way to start to identify this type of scalability and efficiency type issues while doing this pattern matching under the covers. Does that make sense? Is there any other name? What's happened there?
I don't know.
It's about to launch.
Mouse.
What?
I don't know what you've done.
Is that better?
Where is it?
Whoa!
Oh, go back. Oh.
Okay.
Yeah,
so.
That was it.
Response time.
So have we got time to look at we got time to look at a demo now. Is it pizza time?
Pizza hasn't arrived. It's not arrived, but how was the demo?
Let's kick it off, and we can let it run while we eat pizza. If you're happy with that.
Yeah, because the pipeline's really boring. okay, yeah, I'll just basically describe what's going on here in the demo. So, my team is a .NET team that we're trying to diversify. But for the ease of this, we've built the pipeline to sort of demo this. We do all our stuff in Visual Studio Online, so they're build pipeline stuff. Easy to use. It's got lots of nice features, not selling or anything, but it's easy to use. But this will work. Our solution should work for basically any sort of pipeline that you sort of throw together. So what it's going to do is going to deploy a non-performant application that I built. But he asked me to build it that way, so it's his fault. It's in a scaled-down environment hosted in. Azure. I can't remember the exact size, but it's got like one core.
Whatever the smallest thing in Azure.
Whatever it costs the least.
It's still coming out of my bank account.
It still comes out of your bank account. So we're deploying a source control performance test script. So they're all within our source control. So if updates happen to those, they get deployed out. At that point, we'll run a performance test. Thomas could probably describe that in what I don't know if you know the design anymore, but
it takes 3 minutes.
It takes 3 minutes,
and it runs at say 10 TPS, 20 TPS, 30 TPS.
But the rest of the pipeline, obviously takes a lot longer. Our tool will analyze the data, and we push the results back to our pipeline, and we usually go forward, fail. If it works, and such.
And unless you fix that application.
unless I fix the application. So, I guess I will.
So, where are you going? The key thing with the.
The key
thing with the tool is that it's just applying those rules. So, all it is doing is it's taking data from everywhere, data from, in this case, just JMeter and. Is it Windows Box? It's Windows Box, isn't it? So Perfmon for Windows Stats in this case. It's getting loads of data and it's applying those rules to it. Do the things that ramp, do the things that should be flat, other things that should be 0, 0, and flagging up when that doesn't happen.
All right, I'll just kick it off and just run away.
So you're not doing a proper release.
I'm not doing a proper release.
That's when you made early.
That's when I made early.
If this breaks, it's Microsoft's fault, not ours.
They have to update. That's the problem with Visual Studio Online, is they like to push updates without you knowing. So if something breaks, their release notes are near impossible to find for this team.
So we just go to testing run with this, don't we? We don't take it to production.
No, not unless I fix something, but
we know what's going on. We can zoom in.
Seems to pay, mate.
That's really smart.
I don't know if my eyesight will project in these things.
You can all stand up and cluster around me.
It's really not that exciting, so.
This bit is
the bit that happens after this is really good. So you're going to see just. This pipeline spitting logs out, so
This is the bit that you could eat pizza during if there was pizza.
Actually, there is that. The
Find the performance counters are sufficient.
So, I mean, for most things, you can do it with the small stuff off the system. So
yeah.
We usually use NMOM or something like that for Linux systems or Perform for Windows. For some of our clients that do APM tools, which does help when it comes to pinpointing the stuff a bit more accurately within the application.
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, we pull the APM information into. Is there anything that's a time series you can apply the same time rule to?
Right.
So if you've got an APM tool, then
the
response time is a series.
Yeah,
anything that's
affecting the code itself with your instrumentation.
Yeah.
So
anything that's not actually slowing down, causing issues itself, and is creating some kind of time series on those charts, you can still say it should be ramping, should be zero, should be flat.
So is the test running on the same VM as the application in this case, or are they on two?
Are there separate apps in this one? No, we've done it both ways for different occasions, haven't we?
I want to say it's somewhere else, but I'm not too sure.
You put this pot line together.
I need to check.
The answer is maybe.
Could be.
But would it be good practice to always have them separately?
It's better than separate, yeah. We have worked with people saying you've got constraints around, they have constraints around how many instances they could spin up,
yeah.
And for various reasons we decided to run them together, in which case you've then got to be careful about monitoring like processes and stuff within that, so you can't just monitor the whole box with any monitoring JMeter or Gatling or whatever you're running.
Just want to use more laptop.
What's that, your laptop?
It could be having a hard time, I'm not sure.
So it should be, so he's actually getting on the deploying stuff.
Oh
way.
Yeah, it is, it's doing that,
that's
all happening
it's
elsewhere.
Stuff.
It's happening
somewhere. This is very exciting bit, it's deploying stuff.
Yeah.
But what will happen is with this, of course, it's deploying the script. So that is the script to run the test, which in this case is JMeter, isn't it?
Yep.
So it's the 3-minute JMeter script I did. So it's a 3-minute JMeter script. And then there's also the log definition for perfmon and some other stuff just to pull the analysis together and put it in a file. So it's just deploying those scripts onto the box.
So
and once it's there, we'll run it.
So are you saying that once the feature has been deployed to the environment, then the performance test equipment?
Yes. Yeah. So this is all built into that deployment pipeline. So yeah. Probably in a real situation, you're also deploying it to a functional environment and you're running some functional tests there at the same time as you're doing this on the performance environment. But because you can, in this case, running a 3-minute test, it's going to get feedback back to the developers very quickly. So it's not really going to slow down their build process, it's not really going to slow down them. And they're going to go and have a cup of tea, and by the time they've had it, they'll have some performance results.
That the size of that test can vary, so it's not like prescribed 3 minutes. One of our clients, because of how they implemented their CI pipeline.
Yeah, basically, their CI pipeline was very, very slow.
It became so bloated, and they went off and did all this sort of stuff around parallelism, you know, functional streams, other different streams of testing and deployment. It meant that we had like 20 minutes and half an hour to test it. So.
Which we could do about slowing them down because it took that long already. So.
Yeah, and I still think they're having problems with their CI pipeline. So, I guess like the length of test, you can tell them to talk more to that, but it is really sort of dependent on where you find yourself with, you know, how much time you find acceptable to run tests.
Is it really still deployed?
It's not as I say. I think it's my laptop or Chrome, because I mean this is all elsewhere doing all this stuff. So.
Yeah.
No, see, it's like down here. It's
oh,
doing.
Yeah.
It's going to run it. So I added on some fairly rudimentary instrumentation to this. So if we might be able to, we will be able to see what happens. So I had to reload this because this is attached to the application that was deployed.
This is Ian having fun with graphing and .NET libraries in his non-performed application.
This stuff's right out of the box, and this is there's a library called metrics.net. So it just it's just sort of doing some.
Have we got CPU there? So I'm pretty sure let's see when the test starts up. Oh, there we go.
Where?
Right there. No. Hold on, no. System CPU. I think it's running, isn't it? So this is you warming up at the beginning, and now it's running for the
second.
It's going to run low load for a minute, then medium load for a minute, and then high load for a minute. And of course, in the context of this, all these loads are pretty low, because this is one tiny little box. You're running. Well, in this case, is a made up API, but we can pretend it's going to be this API that's going to host our search function on our website. So.
Made up API that's really crap at calculating pi.
Have we ever experienced a situation where a feature has been deployed into the environment, you've tested it, everything works fine, and then you push it to live because of this feature, people comes in and the system crashed?
Yeah, it's. That's why the risk-driven part of it is really important. So there's always going to be some risks that you don't catch at this stage. So testing in a pipeline is about catching as many risks as you can as early as possible, because that'll make it a lot easier and cheaper and risk-free later on. But there's always going to be some things which, for instance, you'll never see until production. So making sure you're monitoring production right, and perhaps even running a larger version of this test in production. And again, you can analyze it the same way. You can still apply the same analysis to it, but if you're running a larger version of the test in production, perhaps overnight, then you can see if there's other factors that impact it. One of our clients a few years ago, this was one back in the days before this, and we'd spent days and nights, weeks and probably months testing this thing. You put it in live, everything was fine, and then it crashed on the peak day because someone deployed a different version of the antivirus onto the production box or something like that. So there's always little things in production which aren't there in test, and having that right approach to risk in production is crucial. Whether that's testing in production or just clever monitoring to make sure you catch them. It's getting a bit busier, isn't it? So we're on stage two.
So this is it's a 3 minute test, I think. What was your when you put through it, three users?
I forget how it's designed, but it's basically three even load stages. So like 10 users, 20 users, 30 users. The pizza delivery man's got lost. Busier. I think it's a two-core box, isn't it? This one? It's a two-core box, if I remember right.
I could check very quickly.
Have you got the IIS process usage on it? That should be twice. I think that's twice the system process usage. What was the last time you ran the server?
Do you ever loop around and look at what's happened in production in terms of calibration to actually sort of validate that what you've done in your performance testing is representative of what actually happens in live, so you can tweak your numbers back?
Yeah, I mean, that's really crucial to getting the feedback cycle, which we're doing. I didn't focus in on it, but if you remember back to my big diagram of all the stuff that happens in performance land, at the end of that is production validation, which then feeds back into the software development life cycle and back into your test life cycle as well. So that should impact your understanding of the risk for next time.
Yeah.
In fact, how the developers act if there's things that they've been doing wrong, how you test stuff.
Sort of specifically, yeah, I think probably that latter thing. For example, you test if you've got in so much throughput equals 50% CPU.
Yeah.
Do you then go and validate that against, well, actually in production we had that much real live user throughput, and it was actually 75, but then we've got a problem with that. Our tests.
Yeah, so that sort of level of analysis in production is really key to getting the test right. Every test is wrong. It's like how little wrong can you get in your test?
So the
more feedback you can get, the better to actually refine it.
So we're done.
It's actually done.
Yeah, it's actually done.
So basically, at the end of the test, what we did was we had it far into this API, which applies those rules. checks the baselines, checks the thresholds and everything, and then spits out red or green.
Yeah.
And hopefully it's red.
Well,
it says test failed. That's
yeah, they changed some stuff. They changed the way variables work in Visual Studio Online recently, so that doesn't turn red anymore.
Their way of saying everything was really awful is they say succeeded partial. That's what you say if people end up being called failures. This is the UI we put on top of an
actual build file.
Sorry?
Where one of the steps didn't actually complete rather than it completed with some failures. I think
I think that's what it is. I think if it built, then it says succeeded.
Yeah, that's right.
And if all the tests failed, it just says partial.
Yes.
It's like, yeah, we built it, but it's a load of rubbish.
It's just a warning, just a suggestion that something might be wrong.
Okay. Do you want to run stuff like this?
Can I click on it?
Yeah.
So this is just the UI we've got on top of the data. So what we do is we pull the data that gets spat out by this test into a MongoDB. We apply those rules to it to create some alerts. And then this is just the UI we've built to let us see that data out of Mongo. So, something I can just do like this.
you can rest it on the...
Sorry, I'm going to borrow your one.
That's all good.
Your work of literature, really. Okay, so here's some of the things it's picked up as either following the wrong pattern, or different from the baseline, or passing thresholds. Okay, so this is what's happening in the large object heap in W3WP, so in iOS. And what we're getting is heap growth, which is exponential. Okay, do you expect some growth in your large object heap? But you don't expect it to keep on growing and start growing faster as the test goes on. You want it to start growing slower, if anything, if it's, you know, perhaps there's something cached in there. So, you know, based on my understanding of Ian's dodgy application and the risks involved, I can see that he's not clearing out he's not managing his cache properly. And we actually got this leak on the large object heap. So, you know, within this time, you know, we can't see for certain what will happen if we, you know, carry on for 24 hours or anything like that. But it is flagging up to us. There's something there which is really going out of the ordinary. And at that stage, the developer would look at it and say, was I really expecting the memory to start doing that? The large object heap is really taking off. What am I putting on the large object heap? Why is it not being cleared down? And they might say, that is exactly what I expect, and I've got something that clears it down after an hour, in which case you might run a longer test to check. But it's at least flagging them up right at this stage. This is the number of low-level metrics of privilege time on the IIS process. So for some reason, it's now using a lot more privileged time on the CPU than it was in the baseline. So back in the baseline, you just see these occasional spikes, like 2%, and now we're running about 6% privileged CPU. And you see up here, we just flag up the alerts that got generated by those rules. So here, the one that's been generated is zero baseline, which means it's nothing on earth like the baseline, basically. Just in the previous one, you should be able to see there, the one that got flagged up was ROF, which is rank zero flat, which is the pattern match. Even though it's fairly similar to the baseline, the pattern isn't good.
You can see on the left there what profile the metric has based on our metric framework, whether it's R, RAM, zero, or flat.
Anything else happen?
That one's not terrible.
Page faults has increased a bit as well. That may be linked to the privileged CPU time. So there's some stuff going on there on the call functionality within .NET that's going on. The memory again has gone a bit strange, so it's a long way out from the baseline. So in the baseline it did recover and clear down some of the memory. In this one it's not, and it keeps on growing up. So that's probably linked again to that large object heap. The other thing you should see is that there's a few themes. Because we're looking at so much metrics from under the covers, there'll be a lot of things which are linked to each other. So this one here with the allocated bytes, you can see that's suddenly starting to grow in the baseline and get spiking a lot more in the current run. So that's going to probably related to those memory related issues we saw earlier. So this is actually the user experience side, isn't this? This comes from JMeter. So the maximum elapsed time that JMeters see each in each interval. And it's again it's similar to the baseline, but it's not, remember response time is a flat, so response time shouldn't be growing over the course of a test. And what we're saying is when we go from our whatever it is, one transaction to three transactions, we've gone from 100 milliseconds to 300. So it's actually taking three times as long. We're a long way below our threshold. I think we said anything under a second is fine, but you know, this goes out into the wild and you start, you know, 100 users start hitting it rather than just three, then it's going to go crazy. Yeah, the processor time one. You can improve that a bit. The processor time has come down since the baseline, look at that. It looks like you've improved it. Maybe someone else in your team has fixed your dodgy code for you. But what we're seeing is it's still not a matter of matching the expected pattern. So you see what happens is it actually grows more than we'd expect it to. So here in the first stage, peaking up, average is about 20 or a bit less. And by the time we get towards the end, it's well over 60, it's getting to about 70. So we've tripled the load, and this was more so in the baseline, but we've tripled the load, but more than tripled the CPU. So even while it's improved on the baseline, we've got a nice green baseline alert, the pattern matching still isn't good. And that's the average response time. So again, that's following a similar pattern to the maximum one. Again, we've got another processor metric, which is following the same pattern. I think those are the three main things, aren't they? The response time, the memory, and the processor.
Yeah.
You got anything else dodgy into it?
No, not that I know of.
What's that funny thing with the privilege time? I'm not quite sure which of the things you built in is causing that. That's probably related to the memory or something.
Possibly.
There's another elapsed time. See if what else is called. That's the total processor. So four, you may notice the process chart we looked at four was specifically IIS. So because we're looking at the individual processors, we can identify which process is actually causing it. Again, this is all just raw window metrics. There's some interesting things going on with the garbage collection, and probably related to the memory. But we're getting on down to the ambers now. So these are things which haven't been flagged up as red, but they are still sort of look at this and it might be interesting to you. So I won't go through all of those, but so effectively what we've got here is just applying that technique. You know, is it following the pattern we want it to, ramp, zero or flat, and is it within expected bounds? So there's some sensitivity adjustments, but it's applying that, flagging up these things as red. And what should happen is you should be able to, I think we've done, look at it visually and say, yeah, that looks bad. But what it's doing is it's saving you trawling through 600, 700, whatever graphs to actually do that. It's just doing it for you in 50 seconds and saying, here's the results. Have a nice day. Go and fix some code.
Yeah,
so
I think
anything else you wanted to show on the demo? Where's the pizza got to?
From my side. So we've got a little bit more time because despite the fact we ordered it delivered, they thought it was being collected. So it's on its way.
We've all got out in the rain and collected.
So we might have a few more minutes. Right. We could do the Q&A and we'll just wait.
There's one other thing I wanted to talk about on the slide, then we can do the Q&A. Because we're looking at some other things and around helping out this technique a bit, mainly in the context of what machine learning can add to it. So anyone who's got any experience in using machine learning or ideas around it, do let me know. But there's two things we're looking at. So one thing we're looking at is using directed machine learning to do some autocorrelation. Because you know, while we can say that's ramp, that's zero, that's flat, coming up with those boundaries of, you know, do we allow it to do this? Do we allow these spikes? Is a lot more complicated. So it takes time, it takes somebody who knows the system, sitting down and doing calibration, it takes some trial and error. Whereas once we've built in some machine learning, so directed machine learning is effectively going to say at the end of the test run, I think this is red. What do you think? and you can go, it wasn't red, it was green. And then over time, the machine will learn, obviously, that this particular pattern is acceptable, it will adjust those thresholds, and you'll end up reducing the number of false positives or false negatives. So that's one thing. The second idea I've had around the machine learning side of things is around correlating the metrics. So you may have noticed on there were like 10, 12 metrics, however it flagged up. There were only actually three problems. So rather than the same for the developer, I found 12 problems. You know, why not spot that these three are actually linked and say, I found a group of problems. It is that your large object heap is increasing, which is causing your IIS working set to increase and ending up with a load of page faults. So if we can, and that can be non-directed because you can start to do effectively clustering of different types of metrics. You know, we always see these patterns together and apply machine learning to that. And then over time, the machine will learn more of what type of patterns tend to go together and be able to say, I think this is a single problem. Hey developer, I've seen these things all happen before. These all might be related. And actually be able to direct you to the answer a lot quicker. So those are ideas that we're playing with. But again, there's a lot of machine learning techniques and tools out there which you can start applying to this.
So you're thinking that machine learning would be applicable to that particular client with that particular software. You wouldn't necessarily have machine learning that your software could go, well, I've learned from this client over here that these things are linked, so I can use that information over here.
I think that, so my thinking at the moment, I haven't tested this out, but I think it's probably a combination of the two. So I think there's some things which are specific, maybe not just to client, but to applications. So, you know, we work with EasyJet and we test their website and we test the system that the pilots use to work out where they're going, you know, which direction they're going to fly and stuff. And those systems probably have quite different characteristics. So you might have a learning per system. But then I think there's probably things you can learn across the systems, which some of which we probably know already and put in there. You know, we've tweaked some of these calibrations ourselves based on the stuff we've seen in the past. But I think once you apply more universal machine learning, and particularly, this is perhaps particularly relevant to us working with a lot of different clients, there's probably interesting things that can start coming out once you start anonymously collating their information and identifying where there's common trends. That's my theory. I haven't tried it out yet.
What would you say are the three most common you see of all the time type problems?
In terms of performance defects, big things or small things?
It could go down. Consistently, the developers are cocking it up.
I've done this a few times for some clients, and to some extent, it does depend on the developers. You get a bunch of developers, and they're always writing a particular problem. I think today, the thing that's become perhaps biggest is around the resiliency between distributed components. So what I'm seeing a lot at the moment is you've got perhaps a system which is doing integration across lots of other different services. And the danger is if one service starts to slow down, that can cause catastrophic effects further down the line. So developers are coming up better at catching things early, like this is just a very complex problem, I need to simplify it. But the idea that this component over here might slow down slightly, and this component over here might slow down 10 times that, and then that component might completely blow up. That's happening a lot more than used to, I think. Working with one client, they've had an issue recently where they used an integration platform to connect into some third parties. And those third parties, I think, the response time increased at peak by about, 50 milliseconds. So they've got a problem there. You know, it should be flat, it shouldn't be increasing, but it increased about 50 milliseconds. And this integration platform for this service, it increased by 50 seconds. So no integration, basically, because it wasn't resilient to that downstream change. We're seeing a lot more of that. I think efficiency is a big thing. Now, like I said earlier, there's a big temptation, I think, particularly with the cloud, and I've probably done this myself in my developing days. You think, I've got plenty of capacity, I don't need to focus too much on making that slick and efficient. And you check it in and it goes up and everything's fine. But again, another client I was working with, and they did this, and we said, we really don't think this is efficient. They were going to have to spin up 60 instances on AWS to handle the peak times. So can you go back and have a look at the code? And I think they swapped out a library, and they got 60 down to 3. So it's, yeah, it's easy to do. And then probably the other thing is, probably another in my top three would be really silly things like leaving debug mode on or leaving in a debug line of code. Actually, there's the same harms as that other one. That one of these teams building one of these integration platforms, they said to us, you know, we're building the integration services here for making payments. It's really, really complex. It's always going to take half a second just to do the integrations. Is it really going to take half a second? Yeah, it's going to really going to take half a second. We said because the business had told us, you haven't got half a second. It needs to happen in 100 milliseconds. And they went away and they came back and it took 50 milliseconds. We said, what did you do? So, well, we found this line of code which wrote everything out into a big file somewhere so that the developers could debug it. And we commented that line out, and now it's a lot faster.
Any other desktop app might crash if it didn't have a deed line, because it was right into the deed line.
Yeah. It's often little silly things like that, but yeah, just get through and cause all sorts of issues.
So this tool that you've built,
yeah,
to capacitate us, integrate that into other companies' build pipelines for them?
Yeah, so.
Does that company have to build write it its own?
We use it with clients that we work with. Basically, we started using it with them to save us time and to keep them happier when we were doing these all this manual stuff and it was taking us hours. And we said, hey, if you've got a build pipeline, stick it in there and save us even more time and hopefully make you even happier. So yeah,
we
can
we have
it
in house, please?
I was gonna say you've done a basic thing of open sourcing it, of course, haven't you?
It's not open source, no, but we share the secret of how we do it, but it's because it's what we use and it's easier. People have said to us, why do you open source it? It's partly because it's a Microsoft platform and it's all